Welcome, everyone. And thank you for joining CACF, the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families, along with 39 Asian American Community Organizational Partners for tonight's 2021 Asian American Mayoral Candidates Forum. We're really excited to kick off Asian American Heritage Month with this forum, joined tonight by 9 candidates for mayor of New York City. And we have over 700 people joining us through Zoom tonight and all of you who are watching on Facebook. This forum is being simultaneously interpreted into Bengali, Cantonese, Mandarin, and Korean, and will be released in multiple other languages following this event. We're so thankful for all the community partnership to make tonight happen, especially in facilitating the critical information that will be shared here to diverse Asian American communities across New York City. My name is Anita Gundana, co-executive director for CACF.
Good evening. My name is Vanessa Leung, co-executive director of CACF. Thank you once again for joining us. CACF is the nation's only policy advocacy organization focused on issues facing Asian American children and families. And for 35 years, CACF has been challenging the model minority myth and building campaigns to fight for equity for Asian American New Yorkers. Now, contrary to the model minority myth, almost a quarter of Asian American New Yorkers live in poverty. And one out of every 2 Asian American children are born into poverty. Our communities face high levels of overcrowded housing and limited English proficiency. And almost 80% of our community are immigrants. During the pandemic, we have seen that Asian American New Yorkers are 2 times more likely to test positive for COVID-19 than our white counterparts. And Chinese Americans have faced high death rates, and South Asian Americans have faced high hospitalization rates from COVID-19. And right now, our communities are facing huge language access barriers on top of misinformation and fears around immigration. Fears fueled by anti-Asian hate that are creating barriers to accessing vaccines. We know that our communities continue to be misrepresented and undercounted. Our diversity across South, Southeast, East and Central Asian communities and our unique struggles have not been acknowledged in existing data. The harmful myth of the model minority not only makes our struggles invisible, but also creates barriers to building and working for a better city across all communities of color and across all those who are struggling with unjust systems that are intended to support us. CACF is a coalition. We regularly work in collaboration across almost 70 diverse members and partner organizations here in New York City to learn about and advocate around the realities of the Asian American community, our diversity, our stories, and our needs.
And tonight is an important night. CACF brought together diverse Asian American community organizations working with South, East, Southeast, Central Asian American New Yorkers over many months to discuss topics that are important to ask our mayoral candidates. Our communities are interested to hear about how candidates plan to make real changes that support our city's healing and recovery. These are not easy tasks, and the next mayor is stepping in at a very complex time. As you've heard, Asian Americans have been deeply impacted by COVID-19 and also this recent spike in anti-Asian hate, impacting our diverse communities. At the same time that unemployment claims among Asian Americans grew by 6,900% during the first few months of the pandemic, hate incidents, those at least that we know are reported against Asian Americans, also rose 933% in New York City over the last year, the highest of any city in the U.S., according to recent reports. The pandemic and more recent instances of violence have definitely informed our questions tonight. But we also know that our community's struggles and experiences of racism are not new. And to truly support our healing and recovery, the next mayor must address more deep-rooted issues and underinvestments that have long impacted our Asian American communities. We hope tonight's forum will begin to dig into some of the pressing issues facing Asian American New Yorkers And it's my pleasure tonight, and our pleasure tonight, to introduce our wonderful forum moderator, award-winning journalist, and member of the PIX 11 news team, Shirley Chan.
Good evening, everyone. It is so good to be here and meet all of you, albeit virtually. Thank you for that very kind and warm introduction. Again, I am Shirley Chan. I am a reporter with PIX 11 News, and I am also a proud native New Yorker, an Asian American New Yorker born and raised in our wonderful city. So it is a pleasure to be moderator of this event this evening. So first of all, a couple of reminders, there is going to be simultaneous interpretation available now in Bengali, Cantonese, Korean, Mandarin. There will also be a recording of this on the CACF website. I want to also welcome the hundreds of people who are joining us by Zoom and also all who are listening and watching through the PIX 11 website. So it's hard to believe, but in just a short month, we will, as New Yorkers, be heading to the polls to do our civic duty to begin the process of electing our next mayor. And tonight, we will be discussing some very important issues that are important to the Asian American community. Our community, of course, we have had a very, very difficult year. I want to thank all the candidates for participating in tonight's forum. And tonight we will hear from all nine candidates, and we will have it done in two different panels. So this is how the evening is going to go, and this is what it will look like. We will hear from four candidates first, and then we'll have a presentation on ranked choice voting, and then we will hear from our second panel, which will be comprised of five candidates. We'll have a set of questions developed by CACF, and we want to thank them as well for setting all of this up, as well as the 30 some odd, at least three dozen, I should say, community-based organizations that have participated in organizing this important forum tonight for our community. So I will let the candidates know what time, amount of time they have left. So we are on a very tight schedule, so we will get started right here. Let me first introduce the candidates. I wanna make mention of Borough President Eric Adams will be joining us shortly. So let's begin first with Shaun Donovan. Mr. Donovan, welcome so much for being here. You of course served as HUD Secretary under President Barack Obama. Prior to that, you were New York City's Commissioner of the Department of Housing Preservation and Development. So just an introduction, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Shirley, thank you so much for having us. Vanessa, it's great to see you. So many of the organizations that I've worked with, not just in my public service, but going back 25 years working in this city, in the communities that have been hardest hit by crisis after crisis. And Shirley, what I would say first is, as a lifelong New Yorker, what made me a public servant was, as a child, watching as homelessness exploded in our city, as so many of our communities in the South Bronx and Central Brooklyn, so many communities of color around the city were crumbling, literally burning to the ground. And I came back and started working for a nonprofit, rebuilding those very same communities I'd seen crumbling as a child. And so I have a deep history leading through crisis in this city that led to a career leading again and again through crisis across the city and across this country. And as you said, I was housing commissioner in the wake of 9/11. I was housing secretary in the midst of the worst housing crisis of our lifetime. When Sandy hit our shores, President Obama asked me to lead the entire federal recovery effort there. And then he asked me to lead the $4 trillion federal budget just as Ebola and then Zika were emerging. And so I worked side by side with Dr. Fauci, all our military leaders, President Obama, then Vice President Biden, making sure emerging global health threats didn't become pandemics that cost tens of thousands of our neighbors their lives. So I believe I'm uniquely ready to lead this city back at this moment of crisis.
Okay, next we have Kathryn Garcia, who of course is a very familiar face. If you have been in the city during a snowstorm, she's of course the former DSNY commissioner. Welcome, Kathryn Garcia. And tell us a little bit about the values you feel will guide your decision-making as mayor of New York City.
Well, thank you so much for having me, and thank you for everyone who's participating in this tonight. You know, I'm Kathryn Garcia. You might not have known my name, but as Shirley said, you knew me when the snow was falling because I usually got to stand behind a lot of salt. But I got into this race because we need to have a city that is affordable for all of us. that is the city that I grew up in, where my parents were able to raise all five of us working as civil servants. That's incredibly challenging to do today, but it is something so important. We have to open up this economy and make it so that everyone has opportunity and economic mobility as we move forward. And as a lifelong New Yorker, educated in our public schools, raised my family here, I'm ready to roll up my sleeves and get the job done. I have been a public servant in the city of New York for the last 14 years. And during COVID, I set up a food program that was delivering literally a million meals a day to seniors, to people who were sick, and to people who were homebound. That is my phrase.
Thank you so much, Ms. Garcia. Now let's me go to Andrew Yang, of course, former presidential candidate. What values you hold that you think will bring forth to the city's mayoral office?
I want to congratulate Anita and Vanessa on the incredible work that CACF does. I've known Vanessa in particular for years. It's just awesome to see and great to be here. When you talk about the values that are animating my mayoral campaign, we can see that our city is badly wounded, and I think I can help get us back on our feet. I was just in Chinatown earlier today, and it's heartbreaking to see all of the small business owners who have shut their doors. There was an entire mall complex that right now is completely abandoned. And the wounds are not just in that one community. They're all over our city. We're missing 88% of commuters and tourists, 600,000 jobs. And the job of the next mayor is going to be to take our municipal budget and activate the entire private sector, philanthropic sector, tech sector to try and speed up a recovery that we have 2 years for. And I say 2 years because we're getting a certain amount of federal aid and it's not going to last us more than that time period. So I'm running for mayor because I'm a New Yorker and I think I can help get us back on our feet.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Yang. So our next part of this is we will do a question. We'll pose the same question to each candidate and there will be a 1 minute response. Let's start with Ms. Garcia. How would you as mayor address hate incidents and support the Asian American community during this difficult time? I mentioned I'm a born and raised New Yorker. I've lived in the city my entire life. I've never seen the anti-Asian sentiment as it has been in the last year, but in particular, the last couple of months. How would you address this really dire issue in our community?
Yes, this has been really somewhat shocking as a lifelong. I've never seen it like this. The numbers are really pretty terrifying. We cannot be a city that allows hate to spread. We have to stand up as I have been standing up at rallies, at candlelight vigils, at marches and call it out. We have to call it out, but we also have to protect those communities, which does mean we need people to report. So we know where to put the resources so that we have boots on the ground, that we have cops out there on the beat protecting everyone. But more than that, we have to embed in our curriculum all of the accomplishments and fabulous work that's been done by the Asian American community, particularly in New York City. When I'm mayor, we're gonna get that done because it is imperative that everyone feels safe in this city.
Mr. Donovan, I pose the same question to you. How would you as mayor address these hate incidents and support the Asian American community?
Shirley, as a lifelong New Yorker as well, I agree with you. I have not seen hatred like this, even having lived through 9/11 and seeing the hatred we saw to Muslims as a child in the 70s and 80s. It is outrageous. And what we need is a mayor who has zero tolerance for hatred. And I would say that that's the record I have. It's not just what I've done as a mayoral candidate, but over decades of public service. I led the charge on fair housing and civil rights as HUD Secretary for President Obama. In fact, President Trump, who was a source of so much of this hatred, calling this the China virus and the Kung flu, I fought back against hatred in this country. And President Trump last year, when he still had a Twitter account, attacked my work by saying we were trying to destroy the suburbs by ensuring everyone could live wherever they choose. That's why I brought together CACF, many leaders across the AAPI community and African-American community in the city, and put out a full agenda on all the steps we need to take, both on law enforcement and more broadly to get to the underlying challenges that AAPI communities are facing in this city.
Mr. Donovan, right now it seems like as a journalist who has covered news in the city, it seems like it's very hard to label something a hate crime. Would you change the way how we label something as a hate crime and increase penalties and repercussions for those who commit hate crimes?
I would, Shirley, but I think we have to recognize that it is not just a law enforcement response that's needed. And this is why I would beef up the Office to Prevent Hate Crimes in City Hall, give it full-time staff and more funding. And it's also why we need to build the relationships with groups exactly like you're sponsoring this forum with tonight, because we know that so many people in the API community won't even come forward to lodge a complaint or talk about what's happening. If we're gonna get the message out, even more important than the message itself is that we have trusted messengers and partners to be able to work with, to ensure that we're getting reporting and trust with our law enforcement if we're really gonna solve this problem.
Thank you, Mr. Donovan. And Mr. Yang, how would you address this fervent anti-Asian sentiment and the rise in these violent hate crimes as of late?
It's been such a devastating time for so many in the Asian American community. And one of the victims of the elderly Asian woman who was beaten near Times Square, that's actually across the street from where my children play quite often. And I commented at the time that easily could have been my mother. Like, I think there are a lot of Asian Americans watching this right now that felt like a similar sense of heartbreak around that attack. There are a number of things that we should do on an official level. We should, in my opinion, fully fund the Anti-Asian Hate Crime Task Force. We should be investing more in our community organizations. 1.5% of the city budget's going to orgs like CACF, while Asian Americans are 15% of the population. A lot of these issues are going unreported, and I know this because I talked to victims who have not breathed a word. But some of these issues are overlapping as well with mental health problems and homelessness. I've committed to reducing street homelessness by more than 50% in my first term. And we need to dramatically bolster our mental health resources, because in at least one case that I personally encountered, there was an elderly Asian man who was attacked by a man who was mentally ill, and it reads as a hate crime, but the attacker needed mental health resources, prior to that attack.
You mentioned that there was someone who didn't want to breathe a word of it. How do we create a safe space so that the Asian American community does feel more comfortable in speaking up? Because as horrifying as these numbers are in terms of the data of these incidents, there are so many more incidents that have gone unreported or underreported. So how do we create that safe space for this community?
A lot of it is in investing in organizations that build those kinds of bonds with people in the community, where frankly, many of the individuals involved have a language barrier to overcome. So if they're in touch with a community org that speaks to them in their language that they trust, they're much more likely to come forward. A lot of Asian Americans, and I can say this, being an Asian American myself, you think to yourself, okay, like what is going to be the value of my reporting this? Like, is anything going to happen? Is my assailant going to face repercussions of some kind? And so I think a lot of people in the community will say, well, it's not important for me to come forward, even though it's vitally important for people to come forward. But you should expect that you're going to have to invest again in community orgs that are building these kinds of connections, rather than expecting, frankly, an elderly Asian woman to call up the NYPD, because that's going to be a bridge too far for many people in our community.
All right, thank you, candidates. Let's move on to our next question, and it has to do with systemic racism. We mentioned the rise in anti-Asian hate crimes as of late in the last year in particular, but really this is nothing new. There has been racism against Asians since our first Asian American stepped foot on these shores hundreds of years ago. So as mayor in this all-important city with this hugely diverse city and a big Asian American population, as mayor, how would you build solidarity between Asian American communities and other marginalized groups in terms of dismantling systemic racism? And let me start with Mr. Donovan.
Well, Shirley, we got to start young and keep at it. And the truth is, we haven't really taught the history that you spoke about in our schools. We haven't really brought the full history of hatred against Asian Americans that has been part of our history, as you said, and we have to teach that. And we have to make sure that it is part of what we have in every history class in our city. But we need to go much farther. We need to be able to build bonds throughout every New Yorker's lifetime. And this is why it's absolutely critical that we invest in the kind of bridges that can be built by organizations like are sponsoring tonight, all the community organizations that are out there. Andrew's right, 1.5% going to those organizations is a travesty and must change. But we also need to make sure that we're setting the tone for leadership across all groups through what City Hall and the mayor himself and herself is doing every single day.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Donovan. And Mr. Yang, let me ask you the same question. What role will you play as mayor in building solidarity between Asian American communities to dismantle systemic racism?
One of the most touching experiences I've had over the last number of weeks is speaking at an anti-Asian hate rally and then a vigil, and then seeing both the diversity of the attendees and also the diversity of the people who wanted to speak up against this form of hatred from the Black community, from the Jewish community, from other communities. People like Jumani Williams and Tish James and others showing up. And as an Asian American, I had to say it was moving because I don't think we're used to other people showing up for our community. And so when you ask about how we can build those kinds of connections, I'm thrilled to say that I feel like everyone feels like we're in this together, where New York City is the most diverse city in the world. There can be no tolerance for any form of hatred against any group, whether it's Asians or Jews or Muslims or Blacks or the LGBTQ community. And seeing the outpouring of support for the Asian American community over the last number of weeks really gave me a lot of hope.
Okay, thank you very much. And Ms. Garcia, what steps would you take to dismantle systemic racism?
Yes, we definitely have to always be standing up for one another. And as Andrew said, I have been at many a rally just this week where you saw a very diverse coalition coming forward to stand against hate. But it is also about who are we hiring? Who are we promoting? How are we walking the walk as employers, as people who regulate employers? How are we policing? How are we out in communities engaging in making and building those bridges? And of course, we do have to make it so there's an equal playing field on how we are funding the nonprofits. I was talking to another politician in Queens the other day, and he said, the Asian American community organizations have rarely asked for anything. He's like, it is time for them to be asking. It is time for them to be at the table and getting the resources they need so that they can support their communities as we really drive past this anti-Asian hate and ensure that we are nipping it in the bud.
Okay, let's dive a little deeper into that, because you all mentioned about how a lot of these community-based organizations are severely underfunded. Let me just recap some of the numbers, some of the data that our organizers had mentioned at the beginning of this. Asian Americans, 2 times more likely to get to test positive for COVID than white counterparts, yet less likely to be tested at all. Asian Americans experiencing the largest increase in joblessness of all major racial groups in the city since the beginning of the pandemic. The unemployment rate is a staggering 25.6%. So a lot of these Asian American based community organizations, it is our first step. It is where Asian American New Yorkers go. So given the competing city budget priorities, how will you ensure equitable funding to sustain these organizations addressing the needs of the needs of our Asian American community? Mr. Yang, let me pose that question to you first. You mentioned that these CBOs are receiving less than 1.5% of all social service contract dollars. What would you do as mayor to fix that?
Well, one of the principles of my administration is going to be fairness. And if you have a community that comprises 15% of New York City and they're receiving less than 2% of city funding towards their social services organizations, no one looks at that and says that's appropriate. So we should be elevating the level of funding to be much more commensurate to the proportion of the city that Asian Americans represent. And the fact is, as you just said, Shirley, the suffering has actually been, if anything, disproportionately high in Asian American communities for a number of reasons. And I'm going to call out one thing that makes me very sad. When you look at the families that have sent their kids back to school, as schools have been reopened, Asians are lagging behind along with Black families in terms of sending our kids back. So there's a lot of work to be done to try to build bonds of trust and connection with the Asian American community. And it starts by investing in the organizations that are doing that work all the time and are too often overlooked in our city. I am going to change that as mayor if I have the opportunity to do so.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Yang. Ms. Garcia, same question to you. How would you fix this, level the playing field when it comes to funding these social service programs in the Asian American communities, which traditionally has been so severely underfunded?
Yes, the underfunding is really quite surprising and honestly something I did not know about before I started working in the food space and making sure that people in all communities were being fed. This is where you also have to start with the data. What is the need that you need to serve and who is best able to actually achieve that? And when you look at these stark numbers on unemployment, on poverty, this is where we need to drive the city's resources to support families so that they can thrive. We also know that they are 95% send their kids to public schools. We need to ensure there's investment in our public schools. It is across the board. You start with where is the need and make very crisp decisions to ensure that there's equity across the board. As we come out of COVID and recover from COVID, it's critically important that we actually be fair to everyone.
Okay, and Mr. Donovan, how would you propose to help these Asian American based organizations in terms of social services and increasing funding?
So Shirley, the first thing is we are only gonna change this if we have leadership right at the very top. I know that every issue is an issue of equity in this city. It's why I've proposed creating the first ever chief equity officer reporting directly to me as mayor. And we would make sure that we are actually measuring the change, because the truth is you only change what you measure and you measure what you value. And we have to value this and make sure that we're creating accountability. What I would also say is as we're investing more, we have to make sure we're investing it in the right way. As someone who started my career working for a community-based nonprofit, working to rebuild communities around the city, I know that so often we think our nonprofits can survive just on the good feelings they get from helping people as opposed to actually investing in them. And that's why we have to make sure that it's not just a poverty level approach, but actually creating wages, working capital, investing in them in ways that they can grow and become the community institutions that they deserve to be and must be if our city's gonna succeed.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Donovan. And I wanna mention right now that Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams is joining us. We welcome you, VP Adams. Thank you for taking the time to be with us. And I'm going to just kind of give you a quick minute just to introduce yourself and let us know and our viewers know what makes you, why you feel you would be a good mayor for the city of New York.
Well, thank you so much. I think the best answer to that is because I am living the life and I've lived the life of everyday New Yorkers. But not only have I been a victim of police abuse, but I also put on that uniform and fought for reform and public safety. I know what it is to be on the verge of homelessness as a child. I know what it is to struggle hard and go to school at night to obtain my additional degrees. I know what it is to know what poverty looks like because I grew up in it, but I also know what it is to be a partner with the various communities in the city. And I say to the Asian and the Chinese and other communities that I'm not a new friend, I'm an old friend. And I have soldiers side by side with you for so many years, 35 years of uninterrupted record on fighting on behalf of everyday New Yorkers.
Okay, thank you, BP Adams. I wanted to make sure you had your minute just like the other candidates. At the same time—
Really, I just wanna let you know, I have to leave at 6.
I was just gonna bid you farewell. Thank you so much, Ms. Garcia, for taking part in this. And I know you had limited time, but thank you very much. So we will say farewell to you here and we will continue with the panel discussion.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. I really do appreciate it. And it's great to be with you this evening.
Okay, take care, be well.
See you all on the trail.
Okay, we're gonna bring in BP Adams and put you in the hot seat right away then. So this is the next part of this discussion where we will pose individual candidates to individual questions to each candidate. They will have 2 minutes to respond, and then each of the other candidates will have 1 minute for a follow-up to that response. So VP Adams, let's talk a little bit about Asian American small businesses. Small businesses are a key mechanism for economic mobility in Asian American communities. I mean, my granddad had a restaurant and a laundromat in the 60s and in the 70s. So I know what it's like to be working in a family like that. We see it as a way to get out of poverty. Small businesses make up a huge portion of the service and informal workforce that keeps the city running. At the same time, it feels like business owners, they have to deal with a lot. In terms of narrow profit margins and taxes and high fees, but also at the same time, workers, particularly those who are without immigration status, they are enduring unemployment, instability in work, and sometimes they're pitted against the business owners. So in terms of this topic, how do you promote small business revitalization while also supporting immigrant workers in terms of health and safety protections, fighting against wage theft and things like that? VP Adams, I'll leave that up to you.
Thank you. And they go together. We don't have to have one without the other. In fact, the alignment is so important. Here's what we must do. We must stop being a city that is too expensive, too bureaucratic, too difficult to do business in. And far too often, the various agencies that ensure businesses are licensed, open, inspected, they do just the opposite. They work against our small businesses. And it impacts that small profit margin that you're talking about. That's why I talk about my 100 plus steps forward for New York City of creating a My City card, a card that would allow a small business to go to one agency, single platform, to get all the items and document the business needs. Second, we need to put a really 30-day system in place for citations that are non-emergency or life-threatening. Instead of automatically issuing a citation, let's give them a warning, allow them to approve the condition. If it's something that is dangerous, 14 days, if it's something that's life-threatening, give them a 24 to 48 hours. First, support our small businesses, and then build out our Chamber of Commerce. Allow the Chamber of Commerce to do the backroom work for our small businesses so they can focus on just doing their job as they're attempting to grow their business. And lastly, we need to look at our procurements for goods and services. We spend over $2 billion a year for purchasing of goods and services. Many of those purchases take place outside our city. Let's focus on our small businesses, give them access to capital with local business network. And this way, our small businesses will have the profits they need so we can pay those minimum wages and make sure that we give the healthcare and other things that our workers need.
Okay, thank you, BP Adams. Mr. Yang, I'll have you weigh in here. How will you make sure these businesses get the help they need to recover and thrive? I mean, obviously, all businesses have suffered in terms of the pandemic, but particularly Asian American businesses that have been taken a hit in terms of shunning even. How would you help the small businesses and their immigrant workers?
Well, the first step is actually to let the Asian American small business owners know what the resources are, what the programs are, and what the relief can look like. The reality is that our community has been less successful in accessing PPP loans and other forms of relief that have been made available to people in their situation. And this is a massive opportunity, but it is really disheartening, frankly, when I talk to Asian American small business owners and I ask them, like, hey, did you get this PPP loan? Like, what's your banking relationship? And there are a lot of folks who just don't have that level of connectivity to our financial system and to some extent our government. So that's one big opportunity that I would love to help address. Nothing would make me happier. In terms of workers' rights, one of the big problems if you have an undocumented worker is that they feel like they have no connection to anything. And if they complain, then they're going to be deported. They don't have any recourse. They have no bargaining power vis-a-vis their employer. So one of my major initiatives to help on that front is going to be to try and get basic financial services to the 11% of New Yorkers who don't have them right now. And many of these folks are Asian American undocumented workers who are paying hundreds of dollars a year they don't have on check cashers, money lenders, wiring fees, and the rest of it. If we can get them basic financial services accompanied with an ID NYC, then they'd have some degree of, frankly, like first their financial services would actually be much more seamless, but then they'd be much more likely to be able to access any kind of protections in the workplace that they're eligible for. I will say that right now, the primary mission has to be to try and get these businesses back open. I would declare a one-year moratorium on small business fines. We need to be a better partner to small business, and we need to make sure the Asian American community actually gets its fair share of the relief money that's going to be flowing out of both DC and Albany. And I would love to make that happen. It would give me a lot of joy and pride.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Yang. Mr. Donovan, your turn to weigh in here on this topic.
Thank you, Shirley. Look, I want to agree with a lot of what Eric and Andrew have said. We have a mayor who thinks we can regulate our way to recovery as opposed to actually helping the small businesses, particularly immigrant-owned businesses that are the lifeblood of our economy. And so it's outrageous to me to go to Jackson Heights and hear about the stories of fines, conflicting fines from different agencies who are telling business owners to do different things a week apart, hearing how difficult it is just to get a sign approved, having to hire lawyers and expediters to do all this. Thank goodness we have business improvement districts and chambers of commerce that can help those businesses. But we have to change fundamentally the approach to say, we want small businesses to open and survive, not just survive, but thrive. And so we have to create a single website where you can get every approval you need from the city, make it simple. We have to invest in the partners who provide technical assistance. And we have to make sure that we're investing the capital that's necessary to get that done. I have an entrepreneurship financing fund that I'm proposing that would really radically change the opportunity for those businesses. And I want to say, Shirley, I'm both the grandson and son of immigrants. My dad came to this city, started a business, and this is a very personal thing to me to make sure we're doing it. The other side of this, though, too, is on the worker side. We know that so many.
I'm going to have to wrap you up. We have to stay on time.
Oh, I'm sorry. I've got the timer that says 25 seconds here. I thought Eric was keeping time here. Usually does. So. Anyway, the last thing I was going to say is, having worked so closely with the Biden-Harris administration, knowing Ali Mayorkas as a friend and former colleague who runs Homeland Security, we have a huge opportunity to create a pathway to citizenship and to make sure that we're building a safety net for every immigrant in this city that includes undocumented folks, because we have to do that today.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's move on to our next question that has to do with education. 95% of all New York City public schools serve Asian American students. Contrary to implications of the model minority myth, 81% of Asian American high school students do not attend one of the specialized high schools. And actually nearly 20%, that's nearly a quarter of all Asian students are English language learners. And 9% of Asian American students receive special education services. So Mr. Yang, let me start with you. How do you see policies like this in terms of culturally responsive, sustaining education and integration impacting the Asian American community? And how would you engage marginalized Asian American communities on your education policy decisions?
Thanks, Shirley. I love this question so much because it really spells out the situation for so many Asian American families in our city. And as you said, the action is not necessarily in these specialized high schools, but it's in the 80% of other schools where our kids are learning. Or right now, unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of them aren't back in school right now. Because even as schools have opened, one high school teacher I talked to said they have 5 out of 30 students in the classroom. And when I go to Asian American communities, unfortunately, they've been more resistant to getting kids back into school. So job one for us has to frankly be to get families back into school. And as a public school parent myself, and also the parent of a special needs child, I can attest to the fact that online education just doesn't work as well as in-person instruction. it's 30 to 70% less effective. It's not working for a lot of families. So the goal should be to invest in the vast majority of public schools where our kids are learning. And for Asian American kids who may be struggling with learning a new language or balancing, frankly, communicating with their parents, in a different language with their schoolwork, we have to do everything we can to make sure they get the additional learning resources that they need so that they can actually learn at the appropriate pace. And when I've worked with organizations that have been investing in this side, like Apex for Youth, we've seen a lot of incredible results when you've connected Asian American immigrant youth with mentors, with role models, with tutors. One of the secret sauce elements to educating kids is really one-on-one interaction, whether it be one-on-one tutoring or mentoring. And so my goal would be to try and ramp up that sort of interaction. I've called for 10,000 tutors to tutor 100,000 kids who are going to be struggling with learning loss. Unfortunately, when we do get them back into school, and a lot of those kids are going to be Asian Americans who've fallen behind and even maybe struggling with some other social and emotional issues as they return to school.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Yang. Now let me move on to Mr. Donovan. Same question. How would you base your education policy decisions in terms of engaging those marginalized Asian American neighborhoods and communities?
And Shirley, I just want to make sure, stick to 1 minute on these responses or two.
This is the 1 minute response.
Okay, great. So first of all, what I would say is I believe there's nothing wrong with New York that can't be solved by what's right with New York. And we should look at what's working in our schools. We have many, many highly successful and highly integrated schools that we should be expanding. And we should be creating more of them in every neighborhood across this city. Some of the most successful are actually dual language schools. And we know, especially for AAPI students, it is an incredibly important piece of the solution. That's why I've proposed in my education plan, which the New York Times called the most comprehensive, to create 450 more dual language and bilingual programs. But I also know that part of the problem is our teachers don't reflect our students. We only have 45% teachers of color. And when we have 85% kids of color, we need to change that and recruit more AAPI and retain more AAPI teachers as well.
Okay, and BP Adams, your response?
Yeah, no, and I really wanna agree with what Shaun stated on scaling up excellence. That is something we do not do. We have the wrong conversations when it comes down to education. We pit charter schools against district schools. We pitch and talk about gifted and talented programs and SAT. But in reality, the overwhelming number of students are not receiving the quality education they deserve. As a person who struggled with learning disabilities as a child, it wasn't until I got into college that I realized that I was not receiving the correct assistance and started really excelling. Our failure to scale up identifies the needs of our children, no matter what they may be, and ensure we create the right environment is what our failures are continuing to be. We have great district schools, charter schools, private schools. We need to duplicate excellence and focus on that.
Okay, I want to do a follow-up question here about education that I think we would be remiss if we did not speak about tonight, and that is the one about the specialized high school exam. The latest data from DOE shows that only 9% of the offers were made to Black and Latino students, whereas more than half of the 40, I believe 200 some odd offers went to Asian American students. There have been calls to eliminate the admissions exam, and it is a topic that's so important to Asian American families. In the interest of full disclosure, I am a graduate of Stuyvesant High School, and like so many immigrant families, we see it as admission into these high schools as a way to a better life. Quickly, I just want to get each one of you in a minute or less your stance on the debate over the admissions exam. I'll start with Mr. Yang.
Hey, Shirley, my wife, Evelyn, went to Stuyvesant. I'm trying to figure out whether you're contemporaries. So I do not think we should get rid of the SHSAT. What I think we should do is expand the number of selective high schools, two new ones per borough. One issue that we don't talk about that maybe you experienced, Shirley, is that kids are commuting more than an hour each way to get to high school. So you expand the number of slots, you keep the SHSAT, but then you add in things like grades, essays, interviews, teacher recommendations, something that frankly reflects the process that many of these kids will be facing just a few years later. And if we do this, then we can keep some of what's made these schools so special for all New Yorkers, but also have them be more reflective of the diversity of our city, which is something I think everyone favors. One thing we have to avoid is accepting that there's some kind of zero-sum game that's going to be broken down along racialized lines. That is the wrong approach for New York City.
Okay, BP Adams.
Yeah, I believe we look at this conversation from a deficit instead of a surplus. And we have allowed 90% of the conversation to deal with a small percentage of students who are in these schools. Leave the eight schools alone, continue the SAT the way it is. As I stated a year ago, and even longer, open five more schools, one in each borough, use different criterias for the five more schools, because gifted and talented is more than just an exam. We have a lot of children with special needs who are gifted as well. Let's use a different criteria. And this allows us to move to a place of surplus and not a place of deficit. Any child that has the ability to excel at a certain level or pace, we should give them the opportunity to do so. And I believe we should also focus on those schools that really need the support that we're not giving.
Okay, and Mr. Donovan.
Shirley, I wouldn't scrap the test. I do believe we need change and that it is not acceptable to have so few Black and Latino students at the specialized schools. But I also believe, as I think the other candidates have said, that we can look at this to broaden opportunity across the city as well. And so I would supplement the exam with other criteria. We've seen examples in District 15 in Brooklyn and many other places of successful efforts to look at weighted lotteries and other criteria that really work. But we have to make more special opportunities available for our children, not fewer. And that it goes back to what I said earlier. Let's take what's working and expand those schools and create more of them across the city.
Okay, let's move on to another topic. And this one, healthcare. And I'm gonna start with Mr. Donovan. You have 2 minutes for this. How will you address the continued lack of healthcare access for Asian Americans, in particular, our undocumented and uninsured or underinsured populations in the city? Mr. Donovan, 2 minutes.
Well, Shirley, the right way to solve this is to have a mayor who can work closely with President Biden, Vice President Harris, with Xavier Becerra, the new Secretary of Health and Human Services, and the Congress to create a true public option and both a pathway to citizenship and the ability to cover everyone in this city. We know that there are more than 600,000 New Yorkers without health insurance. More than half of them are undocumented folks. And so the right way to do this is to have a mayor who can work with DC and get this done. But I've committed, and I'm the only candidate that's committed, that if we don't get that quickly, to create a public option in New York City that would make primary and preventive care available at every provider, not just at the Health and Hospitals Corporation, to every New Yorker, regardless of immigration status. Let's be clear. Folks are already going to our emergency rooms. New Yorkers are already paying for bad healthcare. We should pay for good healthcare. And we know that particularly culturally sensitive providers, private providers in federally qualified health centers and others are doing a good job. Let's make sure we build a system in this city to allow them to get healthcare. And I would do that as mayor. I'm the only one who's proposed a public option to do that. But I also know that it isn't just about health coverage. It's also about the underlying health disparities that led to disproportionate death rates in AAPI communities. And this is why my 15-minute neighborhoods proposal ensures that every single New Yorker, regardless of where they live, would have within 15 minutes of their front door everything they need for a life of opportunity. That means the preventive and other health care in their community, vaccines, tests, mental health care, but it also means fresh food. It means a park to exercise in. It means all the things that would get rid of the underlying disparities, the environmental disparities in health that led to the crisis that we're seeing in AAPI communities right now.
Okay, BP Adams, your thoughts on healthcare accessibility?
I don't think anyone in this race has engaged more around healthcare than I have. Everyone knows my personal story of losing my sight from diabetes and having nerve damage and other healthcare crises. And I was able to reverse that by lifestyle changes. I have a clinic that has started at Bellevue Hospital where we are reversing chronic diseases. But also we should use this opportunity to open accessible healthcare sites in our communities using the retail spaces and the storefronts. We should lean into telemedicine where we could have individuals can have access to doctors to give them the assistance they need through telemedicine. But we should also ensure that we have the information readily available. You could have the best healthcare system on earth, but if you don't have it in the language and the method that people understand it, it is not a great system. And we need to pay more into New York City cares.
Okay, and Mr. Yang, I'll let you weigh in here. Mr. Yang, have we
I'm
lost
muted. Him? Sorry about that. I'm unmuted. I was, you know.
Technical difficulties.
Yes, we should expand NYC Cares, which provides healthcare to so many undocumented immigrants. And one of my commitments is to amend the city charter to measure racial disparities and have the mission of every city agency to be trying to reduce those disparities over time. And you would see, as you're stating, Shirley, that we're delivering healthcare to different groups in the city at very, very different levels. One of the big missed opportunities was we opened two neighborhood action centers, which were meant to deliver healthcare to undocumented populations, and neither of them was in Queens. Such a miss. So I've committed to opening a new neighborhood action center in Queens. I also want to say that a lot of people in the Asian American community get their healthcare through these mom and pop healthcare providers that often speak another language. We have to make sure those healthcare providers survive. Because a lot of folks find them much more accessible than the H&H hospital system.
Okay, I have one more question for our panel, for this panel tonight. A minute each, and it has to do with language access. Asian Americans have the highest rate of linguistic isolation of any group in our city, and that's at 42%, meaning that no one over the age of 14 in that household speaks English well or at all. So the question is, how would you ensure high quality language access services to our communities, particularly for languages that fall outside of the top 10 languages spoken in our city? And I will begin with Mr. Donovan. 1 minute.
So Shirley, it is outrageous that in the city that is the most diverse, where we speak hundreds of languages, and we have a law, Local Law 30, that requires language access, that we have not done a better job on this. And so we need to have through 311 and many other entry points, universal availability of language interpretation. We also know that we have to go farther than just traditional. There are many legal interpretation needs in so many documents and other things that I would create a special program for that. We also need to make sure that we're going beyond that to broaden the language access and reduce language isolation that you talked about. This is why I just go back to starting 450 new language programs in our schools. And we need to keep our libraries open 7 days a week with expanded access and do much more teaching, not just to our children, but to all AAPI New Yorkers to ensure that we can close that gap as well.
Thank you, Mr. Donovan. And now to Mr. Yang, your thoughts.
This is an issue that's very near and dear to me. I think many Asian Americans. I'm just going to share a little bit of like a personal story because I thought people might enjoy it. I went to Chinese language school every Saturday when I was a kid. I wasn't very good at it so that way. There's a ton of need in our community. Our community is so diverse in terms of the type of language being spoken in these households. So there are three ways to try and address this kind of deficiency: people, processes, and technology. And I would commit to making language access a key priority of my administration, because I know right now our city just cannot deliver value to so many people, not just in the Asian American community, but other communities, because we're not reaching them in a language that they understand. So people is translators, processes is resources in other language, so that if you speak another language, you can actually access something that will help get you what you need. And then there is a technological component to this where the translation tools are getting better and better. And so if there's a particular website page or message that you want translated, there are ways that we can deliver that to people in their native language.
Okay, and finally, Mr. Adams.
Thank you. And Kalila, we've never had a mission of having language access in this city. We have never been true to that. We witnessed during COVID-19, all of the briefings from the governor and the mayor, they were basically done in English. And I brought together the various immigrant groups, including those from the Chinese community, as we advocated to ensure that we talked about COVID in the various languages. And so we must be clear on number one, I agree, using the technology, the more we use it, the better it will become. We need to hire more translators. And then we need to partner with the on-the-ground organizations and groups, particularly during the census initiative. We had some amazing organizations who were in place that did an amazing job, but we need to give them the funding to go into these various communities, particularly the Chinese community, and give them the support they need in language translation and access to city services.
Okay, and that wraps up the first part of our evening. I want to thank all of our candidates for your very thoughtful responses tonight and giving us your vision for a better New York City. We all want a better city and we want the city to thrive and recover from this pandemic. So I thank you all for taking the time. Thank you so much and be well and take good care.
Thanks, Shirley. Big elbow bump to everyone out there.
Oh, yep.
Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you, all the groups that sponsored tonight.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks a lot. Take care. So now for all of our voters, I'm hoping you guys will stick around because there's something new on our ballots, and that is ranked choice voting. It'll be the first time that the city's launching it to help us understand more about what ranked choice voting is and what your what you need to know about it before you head to the booth. I'd like to welcome Sandra Choi from the MinKwon Center for Community Action and APA VOITE. Sandra, take it away.
Thanks. Can everyone see my screen? Can everyone see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, great. So thank you, Shirley, for that introduction and to CACF for bringing us all together tonight. My name is Sandra Choi and I represent MinKwon Center for Community Action and APA VOITE, coalition of Asian American community organizations that work together to increase civic engagement in order for our community, many who are first and second generation immigrants, to understand their role in the civic process. The upcoming June primary is, of course, a critical election for New York City, with the mayoral race and more than three quarters of city council seats becoming open. We're going to elect a new generation of local leaders to lead our city. At least nine of the open city council races in New York have an Asian American voting electorate population that's over a quarter, over 25%. For the first time, as Shirley mentioned, our city will also become the largest and most diverse community to introduce ranked choice voting as the new way to vote. So tonight I'm going to provide an introduction to RCV. So RCV is ranked choice voting. And if you remember four key points about RCV, it's this. In 2019, voters in New York chose to pass ranked choice voting system for special and primary local elections. Under a ranked choice voting system, voters can rank up to five candidates in order of preference instead of casting a vote for just one candidate. You won't see ranked choice voting for every election. It will only be for New York City local level primary and special elections. This includes the candidates that you're meeting tonight for mayor, as well as for the Office of Public Advocate, Comptroller, Borough President, and of course, City Council. The winner of ranked choice voting elections must earn a majority, 50% and more of the total votes cast. This requires candidates to build and earn the trust of a broad coalition of voters. This is especially important in a city as diverse as New York City. So how are the votes counted? So all first choice votes are counted when voters put in rank their first choice. The candidate to receive over 50% of votes wins. So there's no need for a second round. But if no candidate receives over 50% of the first choice votes, the race moves to round two. The person with the least number of votes is eliminated. So if your first choice candidate does not win and they're eliminated, we then count your second choice vote and then add it to the candidate's total. This process continues until we have a winner. On the screen, we have a graphic here from Common Cause. So you'll see that the candidates with the least amount of votes are eliminated until we end up with just one candidate that earns over 50% of the vote. So in this case, it's candidate B. So how do you vote with RCV? On the left, you'll see a sample ballot from Rank the Vote New York City. Each ballot will be unique to the voter, depending on where you live and which party you're registered to. Depending on the demographics of the city council district you live in, the languages you see on your ballot could include Chinese, Korean, Bangla, and or Spanish. And on your ballot, you'll see 12 Democratic candidates for mayor and 2 Republican candidates for mayor. So this is a sample ballot, so it's not going to list the candidates you're meeting tonight at the forum, but it'll look similar to this. So remember, each candidate only receives only one rank or circled bubble. You can't rank one candidate more than once, and you can't give the same candidate more than one ranking. If you do this, if you look on the right hand side, the ballot will be rejected by the scanner, but you can always ask for another ballot to fill the form out again. You also have the choice of choosing only one candidate if you don't want to rank them. And of course, you can also choose to write in the candidate of your choice on the ballot as well. So one of the most important things our APA Voice Coalition members reinforce or share with our communities is that you have multiple ways to vote in the upcoming election. This includes voting by mail, choosing to vote early, and you can also decide to vote on election day. The last day to vote is June 22nd, 2021. And remember, if for any reason you are turned away from the polls, it's your right to ask for an affidavit ballot. So don't leave the poll site without voting. And so this is to make sure the Board of Elections records your vote and has a record of it. So tonight, all the candidates talked about the importance of language access. As immigrant New Yorkers, we know that not everyone in our community has the privilege to vote and participate in our democracy. So our APA Voice Coalition members will be managing a multilingual election hotline in the languages listed here. And please reach out to us if you have any questions on registering to vote, making a plan to vote, or learning about ranked choice voting. Thank you for having me tonight, and best of luck to all the candidates tonight.